Is it turned on? Oh, yeah. So first of all, we will be trying to find some models based on supergravity, which will be able to, in principle, describe upcoming experimental data, because there are lots of them we already have, and lots is going to come, especially after Planck will start giving to us the data, well, one tablespoon after another. Now, then another thing is that in many models based on supergravity, we have cosmological modelary problems and a gravitino problem, which I will remind to you soon. It's essentially the problems which are with us for the last 30 years, and we are trying to suggest one solution after another. So here will be some other solution. Another thing which was relatively new is that we have a very specific modular problem related to string theory, which is with us for about last 10 years, and not many people know about it, maybe because it was not fashionable to say that we have a problem. I will also try to say how it is possible to solve it. And then finally, on the way of solving these problems with strong modular stabilization, we may be able to find something which is one way or another relevant to LHC phenomenology. This I will tell you a little bit only about, but we had a paper which was published quite recently. So first of all, I should remind why people start taking cosmology more and more seriously, at least during the last 10 years or so. These are the data of WMAP satellite. And this red curve is, shows you a prediction of simplest inflationary models. These are experimental points which will fall quite along this line. And if you count, this is the first peak, the second peak, the third, the fourth, the fifth, well, maybe even the sixth, hard to say. Each of them, the ratio of the heights of the peaks, and also especially the position of the first peak, they are also very, very informative. For example, the position of the peak shows you that the universe is flat. And for us, the universe is flat was a very, very important point because inflationary theory predicts that the universe was flat. But for example, in the year 97, most of the astrophysicists, they believed that omega, which characterizes flat or open or whatever, omega was believed to be 0.3, whereas flat means 1. And it was pretty serious issue. So this now shows, and the set of experiments right now show that omega is about 1 plus minus 1%. So it's a big difference during 10 years. We suddenly, 15 years right now already almost, we suddenly changed our opinion about the structure of our universe, and this is in direction of confirming inflationary theory. That is more recent results. We together WMAP 7 plus data from South Pole Telescope, and there is another telescope which produced the same kind of data. And if you look carefully, there is about 10 different peaks shown. So people are really finding the structure of this CMB spectrum with great accuracy. And as a result, these data sets start resembling with, the data sets with which particle physicists quite often deal. So if you have this accuracy, you can really find out what is going on in the universe. Many, many models of inflation and alternative scenarios have been already ruled out by this data. So it's very precise and important. So now, what do we want to do? As I already mentioned, first of all, we want to find out a natural framework for inflation and supergravity, which, as I will explain, is quite non-trivial. The second thing is, we want to do more. We want to find out some set of models which would be flexible enough to describe whatever experimental data Planck will deliver. It was okay, it was possible to do it in the normal non-supergravity related models. You just say, I study potential energy for the scale field of this shape and draw whatever potential. In supergravity, you cannot draw whatever potential. In supergravity, you take Mathematica, you put into it Keller potential, superpotential, and push the button, and then after a while, it gives you some, well, surface in multidimensional space, and then you do not know what to do with that, and then you run, well, some equations showing how the field evolves along that, and if you cannot do it, then you ask several students to help you. So it's very non-intuitive, and trying to feed all experimental data in this non-intuitive context is very, very difficult. So we'll see what is possible to do so. And then, of course, yes, we want to solve the problems which I already mentioned. So this part of the talk will be based on the set of papers which we have written during last 2 years. So first reminder, what was the difficulty, the main difficulty of having inflation in the models based on supergravity? Well, this is an example of F-term potential, everybody knows it. So e to the Keller, this part is the nastiest part of the potential because usually people played with the Keller potential at, well, in n equal 1 supergravity before string theory. Usually the superpotential was taken like phi bar, the simplest potential because when you take the, well, second derivative with respect to phi and phi bar, you get 1. So as a result, coefficients in front of kinetic terms is like 1, so you have canonical kinetic terms, easy to work. However, if you take this, you have the coefficient e to the phi squared in front of this. Now, whatever simple superpotential you take, and people typically take some polynomial superpotential, then it is polynomial multiplied by this huge exponent. And as a result, very large field phi, you just go very, very fast upstairs. You cannot have any inflation there. And it's very difficult to have inflation in these models, even at small phi, where this exponent you would think does not matter much, but it does because typically it produces masses of the inflaton field larger than Hubble constant. And if you have it, then you don't have inflation, your scalar field rapidly rolls down. So one of the interesting solutions which was proposed, it was proposed a long time ago in the year 2000 by a group of people from Japan. They studied Keller potential for one of, have a simple superpotential for two fields, S and phi, and for field S, they took normal Keller. For field phi, they took the Keller, which is phi minus phi bar squared, and you may think that this may be something pathological, maybe something singular, but in fact, it is not. Because if you take the second derivative with respect to phi and phi bar, which is important, it gives you the same one as with the previous phi bar, because the phi squared gives you, doesn't contribute to this derivative, and phi bar squared also doesn't. So it is normal, non-pathological Keller. What is interesting about it does not depend on the real part of the field phi. As a result, when you study e to the phi squared, e to the Keller, which was previously e to the phi squared, right now in the real direction, there is no e to the phi squared. Everything starts being normal, so you have kind of flat direction in this direction. In the perpendicular, you still have this, well, like walls rising up very, very, very fast, and that's good, because this means that all fields except for the one rapidly roll down, becomes zero, and that's the end of the story for them. And in the inflationary direction for the simple potential, a simple superpotential, have exactly quadratic potential, which was the original chaotic inflation potential, which was proposed back, well, 30 years ago. So it was a very nice story, at least, formally, this was what it was. Now, what we have found that it's possible, pretty easy actually, to generalize this theory. So I can consider any superpotential, which is a product of field, multiplied by any holomorphic function of the field phi, which will be our, well, a real part will be inflaton field. And then you take any Keller potential, which is a function of phi minus phi bar in whatever, and here it is SS bar. And in this case, the potential for any of these functions, it will be just a square of F of phi, exactly as it was in global supersymmetry, okay? So that, yeah. So that was amazingly simple answer. And therefore, when you take almost arbitrarily, you need to have it holomorphic, but other than that, if you take arbitrarily function F of phi, you can have arbitrarily potential. This is the way how you can bend potential in any way you want. So when previously we could not do it, when previously what we wanted to do, we wanted to find this direction in all dimensions. And well, for two fields, there will be four dimensions, okay? So four dimensions, how it all moves, what kind of cosmology. But in this case, all of the fields will be frozen except for one which will be rolling. So the theory becomes pretty simple. And here is an example. You may, one subtlety though, you may want to double check that this field S and the imaginary part of the field phi, they really stabilized at the zeros. And in order to ensure that nothing bad happens, it's better to add some terms to Keller potential, which if they, you do not need them, you can drop them. But these terms, if you need them, they in principle can be obtained as a result of integration of some heavy degrees of freedom if you want the interpretation. If you don't want, we just study Keller potential which contain these terms plus some generalization, okay? So if we do so, we find out that depending on these coefficients, and in fact, even without them, the mass of the S field is, well, always in this case, for psi equal to zero, for example, I didn't write the full expression. For psi equal to zero, it starts with m squared, and then there is an addition. So for psi equal to zero, it will be just m squared, positive. For this gamma equal to zero, this is a very large positive coefficient, large with respect to Hubble. If field is heavier than Hubble, then it really rapidly rolls down to the minimum and becomes unimportant. So it is possible to check that the potential really looking like that and that everything is stable in this case. And so you can find out the conditions for these coefficients under which everything will be stable and as desired. This is another example. You can have Keller, which is a logarithmic function of this field phi. And again, these are two extra things. And the only thing that changes are the different conditions on these parameters here, if they are necessary. Sometimes these parameters are not necessary. And anyway, this potential of the inflaton is given by the same expression. So here is a just toy example. If I take superpotential, which is S, multiply by phi squared minus some constant, then effective potential will be like Higgs-type potential, spontaneous symmetry breaking, from here to here. Inflation can happen when the field rolls from here, and if the value of this minimum here is large, then inflation may happen also when the field rolls down in this direction. Depending on that, if we try to relate this to the, for example, WMAP data, what kind of WMAP data I'm talking about? Well, this is a graph, and here it is something which is called NS, and here is something which is called R. So NS is the slope of the spectrum of perturbation. If NS is 1, this means that the amplitude of perturbations produced during inflation does not depend on the logarithm of scale. That would be the simplest prediction for inflationary perturbations, N equal 1. And in fact, this prediction was made by Harrison and Zeldovich without any thinking about future inflation because they suggested Harrison-Zeldovich spectrum much before inflation was suggested. But they predicted N equal 1, okay? So quite often people were saying, okay, so what the news inflation did because they just predicted Harrison-Zeldovich spectrum. Well, actually, in the first prediction of the inflationary spectrum, which was made by Mukhanov and Chibisov back in Lebedev Institute in 81, actually, on the basis of Stravinsky model, it was this N equal 1 minus, and there is some logarithmic correction. And this logarithmic correction is extremely important. It's the same like a difference between scaling in QCD and quark confinement regime. So this means that at large values of scale factor, at large values of distance, the amplitude of perturbations grows. And this, in inflationary theory, this is responsible for the regime of eternal inflation in inflationary cosmology. In QCD, this means that at large distances, you have quark confinement. So there are two strongly non-perturbative regimes, and both of them are related to the non flatness of spectrum. So actually inflationary prediction was it's almost flat, but there is non-flatness, the deviation from flatness. So this is n equal 1. This is what WMAP said some time ago. Well, the latest published kind of data from WMAP plus several other experiments is that this point, n equal 1, Harrison-Zeldovich spectrum, is ruled out almost at 4 sigma. It's 3.5 sigma or something like that. So Harrison-Zeldovich is ruled out. Inflationary theory is well. However, we want to understand which of the versions of inflationary theory as well. So for example, chaotic inflation in the model lambda flight of the force. It is here. Well, actually, it is shown by 2 points. And these 2 points, because we do not really know exactly when inflation ended, how long after that the universe evolved after inflation. So depending on different properties of matter after the end of inflation, the prediction either here or here, it's not exact. For m squared, phi squared, it's either here or here. So in principle, it is all within WMAP error bars, even in the simplest models. But if we study this model, which I just mentioned, with this potential, then depending on whether I am falling from the large fields or from small fields, I am either in this region or I am in this region. And depending on parameters, this is the range of predictions which this simple type model gives you. And if you make it slightly more complicated, then it can easily cover all area here. For example, some people played with a potential which consisted only with quadratic, cubic, and quartic terms. And they were able to cover all area here. So in principle, you can do it. The question is, can you do it in the models that we would like? Okay. So the statement which we are making that yes, it is possible. In this new class of supergravity inflation model, we can use arbitrary potential for the inflaton field, and therefore we can describe any values of n, s, and r in terms of supergravity. Does not mean that the models which we will present in supergravity will have some nice motivation. What we are trying to do, we are trying to solve one problem after another. If the data will point out that this n, s, and r are exactly like that, and Planck satellite is going to zoom to the data in this respect with very, very strong resolution, so then we will be able to start our work, and we already know how to construct models based on supergravity, which will produce you the data which these guys will tell us. Moreover, it is possible to slightly generalize these models, and then you will be able to also describe possible deviations from non-Gaussianity in these models. Why is it possible? Because non-Gaussianity usually is related to the possibility that some other field is excited, okay? During inflation, it's not only one inflaton field is excited, but also its brothers. Now, in this simple model, we have three brothers of the inflaton field, okay? Now, the masses of these brothers are taking care of these scalars. And what was found when we worked on that the masses are actually related to the curvature of curvature of Keller space. So you may find out whether this other field can be excited on that or no, depending on the curvature of Keller, of the Keller. So this means that we may relate possible deviations from non-Gaussianity with the properties of supergravity. So that's also an interesting possibility. And in fact, it's not very exotic. If you just take the simplest model, which was suggested, well, in 2000, so it was 12 years ago, simplest quadratic model, people suggested that they did not know. Generated, and therefore you can have additional contribution to density perturbations, and that will be non-Gaussian. Okay, so now extension of these ideas from supergravity to string theory lead to some unexpected things. Indeed, we did not expect that this is coming, so I will give a brief explanation. So until, well, the year 2003 in string theory, we knew that it is necessary to understand why extra six dimensions are compact. We didn't know how to do it. Then the model was proposed which may possibly address it. It is a very complicated construction. We know that it has a chance to work. We do not know any exact statement that it does not. So briefly, in terms of supergravity, it can be described in the following way. You have some volume modulus, and this is a superpotential of the volume modulus. These will have some one particular type of origin in string theory. This appears due to non-perturbative corrections. And if you look at this, you have a potential, which looks like that, and the volume modulus, here the real part, which is called sigma, volume modulus has a minimum. This minimum is, however, in anti-de Sitter space in the state with a large negative cosmological constant, which we do not want, so we need to uplift it. And after you uplift it, and there are several different ways to uplift it. One way of doing it within string theory, saying that this happens because of anti-de Sitter brain, etc. Another possibility is to make uplifting directly in n equal 1 supergravity. In the rest of the talk, I will tell you later how it is possible to do the second thing, how to uplift it just directly in n equal 1 supergravity, and I will explain also the reason why we have chosen recently to do this way instead of saying, okay, it's anti-de Sitter brain, and that's what is done. It is possible to do so, but we start studying alternative possibility after we decided to check, can we describe Higgs? So how is it related to the Higgs? It looks like it's almost nonsense even to think about Higgs when we're talking about the energies, which is like maybe 10 to the 15 GeV. So let's see. One of the problems which we found when we analyzed it was as follows. So the same uplifting which uplifts you from here to here, which is necessary for finding ourselves in the close to Minkowski space, slightly de Sitter, that's what we know from cosmological observational data right now. When we're uplifting, the position of the minimum slightly shifts to the right, because when we are uplifting, it's not that we are adding constant, just uplifting like that, but this is like, well, extra dimension, which shows you the size of the compactified manifold. And if we write this cosmological constant in this context because of, well, some effective Keller potential which exists there, you are actually adding a hyperbola. So this adding hyperbola uplifts you and then decreases the height of the barrier. Or actually, it produces barrier first. But when you continue uplifting it, then this barrier disappears. Who would need to continue uplifting? Well, if there was inflation, then inflation actually is like adding an extra almost cosmological constant, some field which evolves slowly, so you're kind of continuing adding something to the potential. When you add too much, then you destabilize your theory. How much is too much? Well, if we study the depth of this potential in terms of supergravity, and then you uplift it, you find out that the depth of superpotential, quite surprisingly, is directly related to the gravitino mass. Okay, it will take a few lines to describe it, but just trust me on that. So what is happening that previously when we were just inventing this model, we had in mind a model which is model of huge energies, so nobody cares about this gravitino mass or anything. And then, however, when we really related it to the violation of supersymmetry, which happens after the uplifting, the uplifting, see, in this minimum, supersymmetry is unbroken. But when we are uplifting, whether we want it or not, we break the supersymmetry. And this breaking of supersymmetry shows that the depth of the minimum, the amplitude of uplifting, is related to the gravitino mass. If we uplift it too much, this would mean that gravitino mass will be very large. Now, people who study effects at LHC, they think, they expect that gravitino mass is probably maybe of the order of maybe 1 TeV, and why it is so? Because we want to have light superpartners. Otherwise, why do we need this LHC except for Higgs? Okay, so the goal was that Higgs is protected by superbrothers. Superbrothers must be as heavy as Higgs, maybe a little bit heavier, but not much. Okay, so this was the idea. Now, if this is so, what happens is that the constraint when we add up when this minimum is related to the gravitational mass, then the height of the barrier will be also related to the gravitational mass, and then if you add a little bit of inflationary energy to this, then you will destabilize the theory. And the answer is that you cannot have Hubble constant during inflation, which is larger than gravitational mass, unless you're doing something extremely tricky. And people tried. We found this fact with Renata in 2004. Since this time, many people tried to avoid it, and there were lots of suggestions, and some of them are looking almost okay, but always almost okay. Each time people try, and either something very, very ugly is proposed or something which in the end just simply doesn't work. So what does it mean if you take at its face value? If Hubble is smaller than that, if M gravitational like 1 TeV, then the corresponding amplitude of gravitational waves produced during inflation in this case is characterized by this famous parameter R, which I just shown you on the vertical axis for W. It is 10 to the minus 24. Maximum which Planck will be able to observe is R of the order of 10 to the minus 1. Okay? So this is like totally unobservable, absolutely. And then I decided even to do the thing that at some moment I was in, well, writing a proposal for some future satellite, and I told my friends that we must say that if we find there these gravitational waves, then we will be in a contradiction to these, one of these two things, either the modern version of string theory or to the discovery of supersymmetry particles and LHC. So this is how it is important. And then they say, yeah, but this just means it's improbable that we will find any, we won't get any money. So they declined to, well, enter it into the proposal. Fact is that every two parts of this graph can easily work together without any problems. When you consider three of them, discovery of light particles of LHC, modern version of string theory of the type which I mentioned, and discovery of the gravitational waves, all three, they are incompatible unless you do something special, okay? This is not widely known because neither of these parties is interested in showing that we have a problem potentially. The ones which the Planck satellite is trying to find, yes, okay? Now, a long time ago, we proposed the possible solution of this problem. But even to us, this proposed solution seemed to be extremely fine-tuned. And it took us lots of calculation in Mathematica to realize that actually it is not. Okay, so let me tell you what we are talking about. The same Keller potential for the volume modulus as before. The same part, which was part of the KKLT model. And there is this additional term, and this is called race track potential, which actually many people are using. So what's happening is that for every set of constants, A, R, large B, small b, whatever, you can find such quantity, W0, then one of these minima is exactly in Minkowski space. Exactly Minkowski, you do not even need to uplift it if you want to describe Minkowski. If you want to uplift it a little, then okay, you may uplift it a little. But if you want to describe small supersymmetry breaking in this model, you may, if you want to describe it, you may add some term here which breaks supersymmetry in this potential. So instead of this Minkowski space with unbroken supersymmetry and zero value of energy, you will get slightly anti-de Sitter. Now, what is interesting in this model, the curvature of the potential and the height of the barrier will be totally unrelated to the fact whether you have here supersymmetry breaking or not. Even in the absence of supersymmetry breaking, you will have here this barrier. So the gravitational mass as a measure of supersymmetry breaking is unrelated to the height of the potential. Therefore, we can have very large height of the potential, very large curvature of the potential here, so very stable position of the vacuum, and we do not have any decompactification of this theory at Hubble constant of the order of m3 half. Now, the only problem is that this potential must be fine-tuned. What we didn't realize until the last year is that it is exactly the same fine-tuning which everybody in particle physics are doing when they are describing phenomenological supersymmetry. They, for example, take Polonyi field and they write superpotential there, and superpotential looks like that. It is some linear term plus constant. That is exactly this constant which appear in the Polonyi superpotential, exactly the same number. If you want to get small gravitational mass, you want to have supersymmetry fine-tuning, that's exactly the same supersymmetry fine-tuning as it was before. Fine-tuning for zero here, it's unavoidable thing because you want to have cosmological constant equal to zero after everything. And that is something, if you trust landscape, then you say you have so many different options, one of them give you zero. If you do not get your zero, you're dead. And until somebody comes with a better solution, we just do not regard this fact as a fine-tuning. Now, I already just told you about this, that this is exactly as fine-tuned as normal Polonyi model. Now, what do we do next? Next, you unify all of these together. So we add chaotic inflation, the model of the type which we studied before, and superpotential with this part and with supersymmetry breaking and with this part of the superpotential. This, in fact, almost everything was in the simplest model with quadratic potential, which was studied here without some stabilization checking. And what we did, we found that if the, KL, we call it, this when you have a strong stabilization, if you have very strong stabilization, then inflation in this model is possible, and it goes essentially as follows. This volume modulus is so strongly fixed that it does not change during inflation. So during inflation, one can simply ignore it and return back to the previous model, and all cosmological consequences of the previous model have been studied. So that is as simple as that. If you would try to do it in the normal KKLT model, unless you're doing something extremely special, just do not have information of the type which we're describing right now. Okay? Now, another interesting part of this model, is that in this set of models, it's difficult to reheat the universe after the end of inflation. And that is a specific feature, this specific class of models. We try to invent a class of models where we have a rich spectrum of possibilities for inflation. But because of this flatness of the potential, we check the following thing, that in the end of the day, where this inflaton field rolls down to the minimum, starts oscillating, this is a moment when it can give energy to other particles. So it does not. Well, it may start giving its energy, but it never finished the job. The thing is that what effectively looks like a diagram, when one inflaton field decays into whatever, these type of diagrams allow you full reheating. If, however, you have diagrams such that two inflaton fields must meet and they produce something else, then reheating never ends, whatever strong coupling you have. And the reason that during cosmological expansion, these two legs, they become more and more thin. The number of particles after universe expands becomes smaller and smaller, and then there is some freezing and they stop decaying. So if you want full decay, you always need triple counting, coupling, one inflaton to something. Well, so in this model, if you do not modify it, there is nothing like this triple coupling for some interesting reasons, unless you take into account coupling of the scale field to gauge fields. And when we have written a paper about it, our referee told us that this is wrong. If you take normal textbook on supergravity, nobody considers these terms. Of course, when we open it, the old books do not have these terms. The new books do have these terms. But what Sergio Ferrara and Renato found that if you try to build models which are based on, start from super string theory or extended supergravity and then go down to n equal 1, so you care about the origin of n equal 1, then these terms, they are almost inevitable in this kind of scenario. And because of these terms, you have reheating in these models. But the coefficient in front of these terms is something which you can say, this is my new coupling constant. If this coupling constant is small, then you have reheating temperature, small. Why reheating temperature is important for us? We want to have it not too small because, well, people who are interested in production of bodies, one of the most fashionable scenarios is leptogenesis, and they want to have it about maybe 10 to the 8 GeV or so. But we do not want it to be too small because, sorry, we do not want it to be too large because if too large, we overproduce gravitinos. Gravitinos of the mass, 1 TeV, if they are 1 TeV, they decay late, they destroy products of nuclear synthesis, and that is a gravitino problem. So this is what I'm going to talk about in the end, in the last part of my talk. So if we try to join it with the standard model, and once again, what is the connection between the standard model? Well, this was the first surprise. In KKLT model, the curvature of the potential was of the order of gravitino mass. So we cannot really say that string theory is far away from what we are measuring at LHC. So adding to the standard model, we need have this low scale supersymmetry breaking, and there's some complications, some of which known for 30 years, and one of them is cosmological moduli problem. So here is the problem. If you have light moduli, like for example this Polonyi field, okay? Polonyi field typically has mass of the order of gravitino mass. In the early universe, it has potential energy with minimum somewhere here, because when you look at the total superpotential, everything depends on what were the values of other field, including the values of inflaton field. So this was this position. After inflation, the position becomes somewhere here. So somewhere between the inflation and the present state, this moduli field moved down, and then it started oscillating. And there are lots of energy stored in this oscillation. Unless you're doing something, this will violate observational data by 15 orders of magnitude. So it's not a joking matter. And that's why for 30 years, people are struggling with this, trying to suggest some mechanism of doing it. So usually it is associated with a Polonyi field, but in KKLT model, it would be additionally associated with this volume modulus. So it's stringy part of this problem as well. Not so in this model where this field is strongly stabilized. So what we are, and there is this gravitino problem, which I also mentioned. Now the gravitinos, if they are produced, they can do some nasty things to the nuclear synthesis. So this is one way of solving this problem. And here is, we are just adding Polonyi model to this field, to the theory. This is a standard Polonyi superpotential, except for we did not write this constant part. And we can write a constant part, which is typical in Polonyi model, and subtract this part from this KL model, where I added this delta. I can add delta either there or here. It's the same thing. We consider the general model. So we can have supersymmetric KL model, well, and we have Polonyi field plus some contribution which breaks supersymmetry. And after that, we consider Keller potential, which has normal part, and there is something which people are discussing already for many years, the possibility to add these higher corrections to Keller potential, which may appear, for example, if you take a Rafferty model and then integrate heavy degrees of freedom, you can effectively get terms like that. So if you do that, and if you try to find out where is the position of the minimum, in the normal Polonyi field, the position of the minimum will be at x of the order of Planck mass, so at x of the order of 1, usually. In this case, the position will be inversely proportional. Oops, no. The value of the field will be proportional to lambda, which we consider, assume, small to make these higher corrections large. The mass of the Polonyi field will be directly proportional to this supersymmetry breaking. Oh, did I write? Yeah, okay. This is the parameter m, but the mass of the field, this is just a relation between some parameters, so that vacuum Minkowski. But the mass of the field x, the mass of the Polonyi field, appears to be inversely proportional to lambda squared, which means all lambda, you have super heavy Polonyi field. Super heavy means oscillating fast, decaying early, and so not so dangerous. Moreover, so first of all, it early decays, and therefore it is not as dangerous as we expected. But there is an additional thing. If your potential for the Polonia field is very, very curved, if it's strongly stabilized, see, there is this pattern. We need strong stabilization for the volume models, and we need strong stabilization for Polonia models. So if potential for the Polonia field is very, very strong, then it does not happen that you have this minimum in inflationary universe, and you have this minimum here, and then suddenly this minimum disappears, and the field starts rolling here. No, what happens is that this potential slowly adjusts and adiabatically moves to the minimum. And as a result, this Polonia field, instead of falling, it just follows the position of the minimum. And if it does so, the energy in its oscillations, it will be exponentially small, so there will be no Polonia cosmological moduli problem. Now, what is interesting there also, if we follow this way of thinking, and if we assume that Polonia field does not have direct coupling to fields in a standard model, in particular, there is no direct coupling in kinetic function for the gauge field fields in the standard model, then it's possible to show the following, that the split of masses in chiral multiplet will be determined by the gravitino mass, and it will be large. But the masses of gyginos will be produced mostly by anomalies. So they will be like 100 times smaller. Now, if you want to have these gyginos of the order of 1 TeV, you need to have gravitinos of the order 100 TeV, or maybe 30 TeV, something like that. This is what is called split supersymmetry. But now this split supersymmetry appears almost as a consequence of strong stabilization, not like something, why don't we try this, okay? And this is a type of split supersymmetry of very, very special, where you have masses of some particles dominated by normal gravity mediation, and some of them due to anomalies. So this is a specific version of split supersymmetry models. And this was studied in our recent paper. I will just report the result. There are some additional assumptions in the paper. You need some scale of unification, you need some assumption about Higgs masses, you need some source for the this beta, which is a relation between two different values of the Higgs field, because there are two of them available. And you need to add, GM terms, this Judy-Mazier terms, to make this model work. But after everything is coming together, what you will see that it's quite possible to describe Higgs boson in the desirable range of mass. And Higgs boson is slightly sensitive to the value of the gravitino mass, but gravitino mass in the interesting interval is quite possible. And this interesting interval actually corresponds to very large value of gravitino mass, and gravitino of very large mass, they are rapidly decaying, there is no gravitino problem, cosmological gravitino problem. Okay, so conclusions, and this is the last slide. Simple loss of inflationary models is developed, and in this case, you can have any values of NS and R, whatever Planck satellite will give you. One can unify this supergravity scenario with the models of string stabilization. This is not the total unification. It's not that we really started with super string theory and we derived this class of models. It is patchy pattern, but it is as good as we can do at the moment, okay? But if we do it, then we can solve the problem of vacuum destabilization during string theory inflation. And one can apply the idea of strong modular stabilization also to supersymmetry breaking in the standard model, and then simultaneously it can solve the cosmological moduli problem, and it can solve gravitino problem, and potentially it may be compatible with, I do not say that it predicts, okay? I am saying it's compatible with experimental data for the Higgs. Okay, that's all.
relevant to your claim about the fact that you link your supergravity model to the superstring model. Veneziano remarked that in fact that the supergravity associated to a superstring contains to every order of perturbation theory a massless dilaton. So how do you manage this massless dilaton in your model if you want to link your supergravity model to superstring?
Yeah, one step to answer it. Yeah. This is the first. It was a problem of Veneziano model, if you wish. It was the problem which he often tried to close his eyes on, and we were always telling him, but you have this problem. How can you say that you have a pre-Big Bang model if you assume that you stabilized? Now, the first thing which was done in type 2B, first, we found, other people found the mechanism which stabilized dilaton there. Only after that, people starting stabilizing everything else.
So you claim that in string theory, in superstring, there is a non-perturbative
in type 2B.
A mechanism by which you stabilize.
In type 2B model, there is a statement, that all existing moduli there, it's possible to stabilize them.
And how it comes? Is there any simple explanation?
That's not one answer there. It will be quite a lot, but we can discuss it later. This is very non-trivial issue, which is often discussed. And the non-trivial issue exactly before this set of models, it ended with KKLT, it did not start with it. There was a paper by Palczynski and several other people who exactly stabilized dilaton first, okay? So after that, it was possible to stabilize something else. But that was exactly the problem with Veneziano was struggling all the time. So he is right, but not for everything.
Any more questions? If not, thank you. And the afternoon session is closed, unless Augusto...